We're not on air.
I see you on the TV.
Oh, your little light's not, there you go.
All right, go ahead.
Deputy Mayor, I'm at it.
Good evening. Welcome to the April 3rd, 2017 regular meeting of the town council. Tony, will you lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Flores?
Counselor Bello?
Here.
Counselor Hammond?
Here.
Counselor Hurley?
Here.
Counselor Latino is unable to attend tonight. Counselor Martino?
Here.
Counselor Rell?
Here.
Counselor Spinella?
Here.
Deputy Mayor Berry?
Here.
And Mayor Montaneri will be late. Thank you.
Thank you. The first item on the agenda is a proclamation. April 4th is a recognition of service for AmeriCorps and Senior Corps. And I'm going to read the proclamation. You want to come up?
The following proclamation is a recognition day for national service. Whereas service to others is a hallmark of the American character and central to how we meet our challenges. And whereas AmeriCorps and Senior Corps participants address the most pressing challenges facing our communities, from educating students for the jobs of the 21st century and supporting veterans and military families to providing health services and helping communities recover from natural disasters. And whereas Weathersfield is a very strong volunteer community, not only our volunteer fire department, the oldest continuing department in New England, and our volunteer ambulance, but also members on boards and commissions. And whereas national service expands economic opportunity by creating more sustainable, resilient communities and providing education, career skills, and leadership abilities for those who serve. And whereas national service represents a unique public-private partnership that invests in community solutions and leverages non-federal resources to strengthen community impact and increase the return on taxpayer dollars. And whereas Weathersfield service participants demonstrate commitment, dedication, and patriotism by making an intensive commitment to helping, a commitment that remains with them in their future endeavors. And whereas the Corporation for National and Community Service shares a priority with county officials and mayors nationwide to improve lives, strengthen communities, and foster civic engagement. Therefore, be it resolved that Paul Montaneri, Mayor of the Town of Weathersfield, on behalf of the Town Council, do hereby proclaim April 4th, 2017, as National Service Recognition Day, and encourage residents to recognize the positive impact they have, not just in Weathersfield and Connecticut, but also by participating with others in national service in our country, to thank those who serve and to find ways to give back to their communities. And it will be signed by the mayor when he gets here. So thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
The next item on the agenda is a presentation from the Weathersfield Early Childhood Collaborative.
Good evening, and thank you for having us. My name is Kim Bauman, and I'm the Early Childhood Coordinator for the Town of Weathersfield. And I'm here with my partner, Martha Keneally, who's the Accountability Coordinator for WEC, which stands for the Weathersfield Early Childhood Collaborative. When WEC sought community investment in early childhood last year around this time, one of the things we emphasized was the value of building an early childhood infrastructure in Weathersfield. Typically, when we think of a town's infrastructure, we think of roads and sidewalks and buildings. but infrastructure can also mean technology and people. And a lot has happened in the last year, and we're here tonight to give you an update on our work. Since we saw you last, WEC has completed a community-based strategic planning process. We've successfully hosted our annual meeting, and the topic was family and community engagement. We established an office in social and youth services, and this is very important because it directly connects us to young families. It's helping us to further identify community needs, and more importantly, it's enabling us to identify the great resources here in town and to connect parents with needed resources. We're in the process of applying for a grant to establish a two-generational family literacy program, which includes workforce development and high-quality early care for children. For many years, we've talked in Weathersfield about growing a bench of parent leaders. And over the last year, WEC was successful in applying for a grant from the Liberty Foundation and Hartford Foundation for Public Giving, which is helping us to run our first in-town UConn People Empowering People Parent Leadership Training Program. PEP is a 10-week program which connects parents to local resources and empowers them to make a difference in their community. And we have a diverse group of 12 participants who will be graduating on May 11th. So look for invitations in your mailboxes. And I think that it was very important what they just said about AmeriCorps, because it's the same principles that WEC operates on, which is that volunteers in our community are so important, and there is a return on investment for all of their hours put in. And Colleen, who was standing for the AmeriCorps proclamation, is also a member of our first parent leadership training class, and we look forward to seeing great things from her. We're sure that this group of parent leaders will continue to make a difference long after the parent training is over. And now, Martha's going to walk you through our new virtual-based Family Resource Center.
Thank you. One of the major milestones in building early childhood infrastructure has been the development of WEC's Virtual Family Resource Center. It's up on the screen, and I'm going to take you on a tour, but if anyone here at home wants to sign in or take a look, the web address is www.weathersfieldchildhood.com. That's weathersfieldchildhood.com, just straight Weathersfield Childhood together. A big caveat, we have not officially hung out our shingle on the Family Resource Center, so the site is still in its testing stages. It just came online in the last few days, and this is the first time we've showed it publicly outside of our collaborative. Tonight is step one in seeking community input on how it looks and what we can do to make it the best resource possible for families of young children in Weathersfield. So to give you an idea about why it was created and what the criteria for inclusion on the site is, one of WEC's earliest strategic objectives was to identify and promote a central place where residents can access information about child care, early learning, and parenting tools. That was one of the major strategic goals of the community plan that was created. It has to be 8 or 9 years ago now. The goal of this virtual family resource center is to provide a single point of entry for Weathersfield families with young children to access resources and get engaged in our community. We seek to include resources and events that are in line with WEC's mission, vision, and initiatives, and we absolutely welcome community input. The layout of the site is reflective of the mission that we reaffirmed through the strategic planning process we went through last fall. WEC continues to focus on making sure kids in our community are healthy, ready for school, and connected to community, and you can see that those goals are right up front and center on the website. As Kim said, there's many wonderful resources in our community, but getting that information can sometimes be tough for families because it's in so many different places. So one of the objectives was to take information that's traditionally classified in silos, like this is school, this is town, this is community, and bring it all together. The information you see is directly taken from all of those different places, and whenever possible, we connect our visitors back out to the original sources so they can get much more in-depth information. So let's take a look. So for instance, let's say I'm a parent who wants to learn more about schools. So I might click on our Ready for School tabs, and that's going to take me to a whole section on all various things that I can learn about schools, early care providers, preschools in Weathersfield, the preschool experience. Maybe I want to learn, maybe I need to know where, just about our public schools in general. So I'm going to dip in here. It's going to give me some information about the public schools and their mission. I might not even know where my child, if I'm new, is supposed to go to school. And so I can click on a map here, and I'm, if, let's say I live on Garden Street, which is over in this vicinity. That's that purple zone. And so that's Hamner School. You can poke around and look at that. If I go back, I can see a little bit of information about Hamner, and this will even connect me right to the Hamner's PTO website so I can get a little bit more information about the school. Again, bringing all of those things that we typically find in different spots all into under one roof. Let's say I decide it's time for my child to, and it is time for your child to register for kindergarten if you haven't. So let's say it's time for my child to register for kindergarten. I'm going to go back out to Ready for School, and there's a tab there about kindergarten registration. Again, this is going to take me through some information that I need to know. Like it's going to give me instructions. It's going, again, where is my child going to go to school? You shouldn't have to get lucky because you found it on the other page. We're going to repeat it in different places so that it comes back around again. What is it that I need to bring with me? What do I have to have with me? And then here, as you read through, it's going to take you right to the Wethersfield Public School website so you can go right to the online registration portal and start to sign in and have that. Coming back around, let's say what you're interested in is some things in the community. So we have amazing resources in our community for families. There's parks, there's musical opportunities in museums and different things. Sports are a big part of community life here in Wethersfield. We have 9 different leagues that we're featuring here, both recreational and competitive, and we link to each information about each league, but because we're early childhood, we make a special effort to show at what age your child might be able to start. You can start to learn to skate when you're about 3 years old. Basketball starts in grade school, for example, and so that's things parents like to know. One of the ones that was a personal interest, I think, just Kim and I, it had been important when our kids were young to take music and arts classes. And so we went through and we looked at the various music and arts opportunities in Wethersfield. And it was funny because as we were putting this page together, a mom literally came into the office looking for some resources with a little baby and said, you know what I'd really love is a music class. She said, well, we have some music classes for you. So we showed her how she might find a music class in Wethersfield. Back out, I'll show you the last thing. There's a lot of different things under so many opportunities. Get out and play. We were really overwhelmed by the amount of recreational space that's available. There's literally hundreds of acres of playgrounds, parks, trails, and whatnot in Wethersfield. The way we categorized it, just as from a mom's point of view, you want to know if there's a playscape there. And so we put all the playscapes together. And then down here, these are places you can picnic, you can go sledding, skating, you can fish. You can play bocce in Wethersfield, whatever it is. So there's lots of different things. And there just are so many different opportunities to get out with your children. We were really amazed by that. It was fun to look at that and learn about that. I'm not going to take you through every tab, but you can see under Healthy Kids, for example, we have prenatal health resources, opportunities to connect with insurance if you need that, a list of the pediatricians and dentists that are located in Wethersfield, developmental milestones. Resources are another particularly interesting one where, and again, some of these things we're still populating some of the thumbnails, but social and youth services. What if you need food assistance? You can connect to that here. Housing and different things like that. What we think is powerful about this tool for parents is that there's information you might have spent hours seeking in different sources, in different places, and we've collected it all in one spot. And our hope is that you might come to look for one thing, but you're going to find other things. So you came looking for maybe an early care provider, but you realized if you had food insecurity, you can get information there, or that that Wethersfield Public Library has an amazing museum pass program and that you never knew about, and you can link to that information here under the community tab. Let me take you back home, and I'll just show you a couple other things. Our pictures are almost 100% our beautiful Wethersfield children, and as you scroll through, you'll see different Wethersfield children here. Couple of notes up here at the top, there's a language tab, and so let's say you are a Bosnian speaker, and so you can convert it into Bosnian, but there is a myriad of languages. You can find, you can even look at it in Irish if you wanted, if you're a Gaelic speaker. There you go. So there is I don't want to say every language on the sun, but we have a lot of languages. And so that's, wait a second, let me get it back to, oh, I did. We're still finding our way around. There's a search tool, so if you just want to put in play, you want to go out and play, it's going to take you to different places on the website, and some of this is still being cleaned up, but different places on the website where you might learn, where you have an opportunity to play. I'm going to take you back to the beginning. We have a calendar that we will be building out. That's still under construction. But this will be a spot where people can check in with different activities that are going on in town related to young children. And it is also mobile friendly. And that was very important to us, considering the amount of that there are some people who really don't even have computers at home and depend on their mobile devices, or the reality that many of us are out and about looking for something to do, and it's quicker and easier to check on the mobile device. And so one of the things as we go through our testing is we're going to make sure that that's really working for people, on the mobile side. Building this virtual family resource center is a collaborative community project, and we're seeking feedback. So there's a couple of options. One is to call Kim and tell her what you think, or to email her. And I don't think that's one thing,
the
phone number is still incorrect. So it'll be correct tomorrow. And her email address will be there. And so you can check back here. But Kim is at Town Hall. And then on our calendar, we also have set up, if you looked at our calendar, there's going to be a Virtual Family Resource Center feedback session this Friday from 10 a.m. to noon at the library in the community room. Please feel free to bring your children. If you have a device that you can come with, a laptop or a phone or some kind of tablet, and bring it along and poke it and, you know, take it out for a spin, kick the tires, tell us what you think. Please bring your children. Did I already say that? Feel free to bring your children. And that will be an opportunity to talk to us directly. We'll be there. We will plan more of these. We're going to do one in the evening, but this will be the first one for anyone who's available during the day. So I just want to wrap up to say it's been really a pleasure to work on this project. We both live in town, and I think we took a lot of pride in what we found in our community and all the great resources that were available, and we hope it'll be a valuable tool, and it's something that we want to continue to see grow and hopefully be something that parents can depend on in our community. So that's it. If anyone has any questions or if you want to look at something specific, we can take a look.
I think the last thing I wanted to add is, you know, when we meet parents, specifically in social services, not all parents have computers or phones. So we do still have the WEC resource guide, which we're going to be updating. But we are finding that majority of parents do have phones. So anything that we do townwide, we just want to make sure that it's mobile friendly, because parents do as much as registering for kindergartens from their phones. We can definitely direct them towards the library so that they can do things there, but that was a huge push. So we'll try to have things in multiple mediums. Thank you.
I'll just scroll down on here so you can see also on the front page there's quick links, featured announcements. Don't forget it's time to register for kindergarten. And this will be where upcoming events are also scrolling through.
There it is. Any questions? Yes, Amy.
Thank you. I think this website is great. I know that when my oldest was, two or three, I was looking for programs and I had no idea where to look. So,
yeah.
And then you move on to preschool and all that. So I think the preschool aspect of it is wonderful because it was very difficult to know where the schools, you know, the different preschool options you had
right.
in town.
Right. And so here, again, just going through every preschool that's located in Wethersfield, we have a link to that preschool. That's the preschool, they're a website. We invited them all to provide us a snippet about their program, and so they've given you a little bit of an idea. And so that's all there. The same thing with early care providers. The early care providers that are located in Wethersfield are listed here, so you can have a direct contact. We always say we don't advocate this. The inclusion on this list in no way indicates endorsement of any program. These are things that are found on sites like 211. It's just a matter of us bringing them together to make it easier for folks in Wethersfield.
And how often do you plan to update the site? Because it seems like it's going to always be in motion?
We worked hard. That was something, actually, as we talked to the web developer, it is no one's full-time job to maintain this. And so we talked to them about making it so, for example, calendar events will expire on their own. You don't have to continue to clean it up. And we're looking at ways to get community input on the calendar. I think whenever possible, we avoided a specific date. You know, nothing says 2017 on it, so that it can, so it will be something we, because again, we're in the business of looking at what's going on with early childhood. As things come to our attention, we'll make updates, but we did try to make it so that it was less labor intensive on that end.
Good. Yeah. Looks good. Thank you.
Yep.
So. All right. Thank you.
Thank you both.
Okay.
I agree with Amy. It is an amazing site, and having it all in one location is critically important, because it does take, there are so many places you can look, and frankly, some sites are better than others.
Yeah.
So having it all in one spot is going to be helpful to folks new to town and those that have been here for years.
Right. It's something we encourage realtors to share with people and to, you know, and as many people in town to have that to say, oh, you know, go ahead and check the weathersfieldchildhood.com.
So thank you both.
Okay, thank you.
Is this ours?
Yeah, and that's my
again in a few minutes.
Thanks, Jeff. We are at public comment. Anyone here to speak this evening? Public comment? Anything, Tom?
Good evening. I am Joe Canacci. I'm a longtime resident of the Wells Quarter Village section of town. I'm here this evening to draw your attention to a petition concerning the concrete weir and embankment dam in the south-southwest area of Wintergreen Woods. This structure has slowly deteriorated over the years and is now in poor condition. To my knowledge, this issue has been discussed in various capacities and varying levels over the past decade or so, and you and your predecessors have had the foresight to include a line item in the drainage section of the current capital improvement program. Yet a line item is not the same as an allocation. I speak here this evening primarily in the interest of those signatories of the aforementioned petition. The bulk of those individuals live in the Wells Quarter Village and other areas to the west of Wintergreen Woods. For them, the trail that leads over the dam and embankment is the only foot access to the wonderful passive recreational opportunities we have in Wintergreen Woods. As the weir has crumbled and the dam has eroded, more and more of these citizens feel that the trail is no longer safe, and therefore that Wintergreen Woods is not open to them. Now, not all people who use Wintergreen Woods are quite that cautious. And some individuals have attempted to bridge the void in the dam by tossing in debris. When I walked to the dam this afternoon, I found some planks nailed to logs and a slapdash footbridge. However, with continued erosion, this structure, if you can call it that, was more of a teeter-totter than a bridge. That sort of fix increases the safety issues rather than decreasing those sorts of problems. And I believe that Conway v. Wilton remains the law in terms of municipal recreational liability. That liability question also compels me to speak from the taxpayer's perspective. It is deferred maintenance that has deprived the people living to the west of Wintergreen Woods of passive recreation. And the cost of repair, removal, or replacement will only increase with future high water and frost heaves. Does the council have any questions that I might be able to answer on this topic? Thank you for your attention this evening, and I'd also like to thank Barbara Diston for her efforts in spearheading this petition.
Thank you. Tom?
Good evening. Tom Mazzarella, 600 Walcott Hill Road. Tomorrow I will reach one of those milestone birthdays, and I will officially join the group of people known as old. I double-checked this morning when I looked in the mirror. There's no getting around it. I'm old.
Speak for yourself.
You're ahead of me.
Right. That was not nice.
In a couple of months, I will also become part of another group known as retirees. That represents some 20-25% of the town's population. Retirees are part of a larger group of Wethersfield taxpayers which live on a fixed income. Most people in this group receive little or no significant annual increase in any pension or Social Security income, certainly not the 2.94% increase that our Board of Education has requested. Getting old here, I got out of. I was unable to attend the Board of Education budget presentation last meeting, but was able to watch the video. Seemed to me as if Mr. Emmett used a playbook on how to push a budget through the process. It looked like a simple four-step process. Step one, explain that the majority of the budget, 98.5%, goes to salaries and employee benefits, which are contractual in nature and entirely out of the Board of Education's control. Step two, include a long list of items that the Board of Education needs desperately but didn't include in the budget to show just how hard everyone worked to trim the budget down to a mere 2.94%. Step three, mention surrounding towns that are asking for budget increases higher than Wethersfield, and use this as a justification for the modest 2.94% increase. And step four, rally support and fill the council chambers with parents and students. We all know the squeaky wheel gets the oil. I'm here tonight to be a squeaky wheel and to urge the council to flat out reject the Board of Education budget and demand that the Board of Education return with a near 0% increase. With all of the uncertainty regarding state funding, I don't see how you can approve anything else. You're all very familiar with the state-mandated minimum budget requirements, and this is what should be adhered to, the absolute minimum. The Board of Ed and the town must learn to live within their means, just as the majority of town taxpayers must do to keep their household budgets balanced. We taxpayers don't have any mechanism to increase our income. We can't simply raise a mill rate to generate more income. It's time we face some facts, that our current economic climate has not recovered from the 2008 downturn. Yes, things have greatly improved. Employment numbers are up, but salaries have not rebounded as well, and many people who lost jobs fell out of the job market, took early retirement, or took lower paying jobs in order to get by. I believe that providing a good education is key to the future success of our youth and of our town, and I have no problem paying my fair share. I believe the vast majority of taxpayers in Wethersfield would agree with me on that. The problem is the cost of education in this town is consuming the town budget. When you factor in the debt service and other contributions the town makes towards education, it's starting to approach 70% of every taxpayer dollar. We have a population of about 26,000 and about 3,600 students, which represent 14% of the population. Yet we're spending the vast majority of education. One resident commented at the last meeting that during the Board of Education presentation, we learned of all the progress that was made in education. Improved SBAC test scores, Hamner School being recognized as a school of distinction for higher performance and high growth, and we are told of improvements in math as a result of new programs implemented in the past year. All of this was accomplished with a near-zero budget increase last year. So it can be accomplished. This proves that we don't need to continually increase education spending to get results. We are told year after year that the highest portion of the budget goes to wages and benefits, and that these are contractual obligations. What doesn't get mentioned is that these contracts are negotiated by the Board of Education and the superintendent's office. What also doesn't get explained to the public is the system of wage steps and lanes that are negotiated with the teachers' unions. For example, the current contract, which was signed several months ago, appears to have an annual increase of 1.5% in the first year, 1.5% the second year, and 3.2% in the third year. The Board of Ed budget summary presented showed a 1.94% increase. However, in addition to these annual percentage increases, teachers advance a step or year. For example, a first-year teacher with a four-year degree would advance from step one to step two and receive a 5.78% raise, and then a 6.25% raise when they advance to step three. In another example, I looked at an eighth-year teacher receiving a 9.7% increase when moving into the ninth year, and a 10.69% increase when advancing to the tenth year. These percentages vary depending on years in service, up to a maximum of 10, and also advance significantly when a teacher receives an advanced degree, such as a master's or master's plus. One resident commented at the last meeting that they felt Weathersfield teacher salaries were actually low and should be increased in order to retain quality educators. I looked at last year's data, and it seems to me that Weathersfield is a highly desirable place for teachers to spend their entire career. At the end of last year, we had 93 teachers, roughly a third of the teachers that were at the maximum 10-year salary step, and they're all earning in the high 90s. Personally, I feel that the salaries and benefits are more than adequate, and I see that Weathersfield teachers are not leaving for better-paying jobs and with better benefits. The average taxpayer isn't getting those kind of raises each year. The Board of Ed needs to do a better job of negotiating these contracts. And if the board chooses to continue along this path of continual increases, then they must learn to find money for the salary increases in other areas within their own budget. As you know, the town council doesn't meddle in their budget line by line. It's up to them. Many will say you can't limit education spending if you want to attract new people to town. Well, I say you also need to keep taxes affordable to attract new buyers and to retain the ones you currently have, many of whom have been contributing to the tax base most of their lives. Thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you, Tom. Other public comment this evening? Mr. Young?
Good evening. Robert Young, 20 Copper Mill Road. I agree with what Tom just said. And all about the costs and how we're getting taken over by this group here that just continues to tax us and the Board of Education as well. There was an article in the Connecticut Mirror just recently, and the economist Panera, Connecticut budget is in a state of emergency. We all know this guy up at the state capitol, the budget manager, Ben, I forget what his last name is. He talks about we're in a fiscal crisis. We're in all kinds of crises. And, you know, he is right, a 0% increase. Matter of fact, it should be less than 0%. And that's what's needed. And it's been needed for years. But without that, we're going to just keep sinking. And we're going to end up like Hartford. Tonight you had the early childhood collaborative talk to you about their program. While I'm sitting out there listening to the different things that they offer, I can get all of that off the internet. Years ago, when we needed health child care, there was no problem. There was a number of places to go, and they're still there. There's all kinds of literature out there. We don't need to pile up with more administration and more costs. You know, you gave them $3,000 last year, roughly. You're going to give them, you want to give them more. We shouldn't give them any more. This is another eternal life program, and we can't afford these kinds of things. This is, especially since it's already being, all they're doing is replicating what's already out there. The internet is fantastic. There's all kinds of stuff out there. Everybody's got their little telephones or their home computers where they can tune in and find whatever in the world they need. We don't need some other group that we're going to pay for to do the same thing. That's called duplication. There's an article in the Hartford Courant. City expects to lose $5.5 million on Dunkin' Donuts stadium. What else is new, huh? They just keep losing because they are the worst managers in the state, except for the state of Connecticut. They're the number one worst. The Hartford's next. And losing $5.5 million, they deserve to lose that. The problem is, their stupidity goes right on into every town across the country and across the state, which also includes Wethersfield. Tom talked about the budget. He also talked a little bit about the Board of Education budget. And I was looking this past couple of weeks. Oh, first of all, I have to ask you folks. At your last town council meeting, when the manager was here, when the superintendent was here, I believe Mr. Hurley asked if he would provide, that's the superintendent, would provide the actuals to date, that's July 1st till now, and his projections for the rest of the year. Have any one of you received that?
Yes.
I made the same request. My answer is no. My answer is no. I didn't get it. I asked him for the same thing that you guys got. So you tell me if I'm a happy guy now? Let me tell you something. I've been looking at the off-book account for the Board of Education, something nobody knows about. The off-book is called the Athletic Fund. $500,000 flowing through that baby over the last number of years. Expenditures that are unbelievable when you look at it. A deficit. Rough number, $500,000 of revenue, $650,000 worth of expenditures to the report that I received. If they're $150,000 off, I don't know what's going on. And then when I look at that expenditure list that they spend on, it's tremendous. It's every Tom, Dick, and Harry who is called an official picks up a paycheck. He's got so many people on the payroll that we don't know about. These dollars, Mayor, should be in the budget. He's expending them. The superintendent is expending these dollars. He's taking in revenues. Those revenues should be in his budget. And for years, and I don't know if it ever has been, I have questions with them, and I hope to meet with them next this coming Friday. But the fact is, Mayor, there are expenditures in here that have no business in here. And this is why. This is one of the reasons why we have no money in the student fund to pay for turf at Mortgage Field. It's mortgaged. We're constantly mortgaging it. The taxpayers got raped over the coals. Cost what? $1.2 million to put that field in. We got raped over the coals. No money from any of the efforts of gate receipts and concessions and whatever else that we should have been generating funds from. Tony said at the last meeting, oh, we're going to ask for a dollar per ticket that's sold. I say to you, Tony, how many tickets do you expect them to sell? Don't you have a projection? You should give us that projection that you're going to show us. Yeah. Ask them for their head count. Ask them how many people walked through the gate that paid. Nobody knows. Nobody knows, Mayor. And then when I look at this, I say, signs on demand, a lot of dollars. Engineering, Hamden Engineering Corporation. What in the world is an athletic fund making a payment on that? Here's a good one for you. SCADA Lawn and Landscape, $10,000. And the reason, or the comment, says Catone's Picnic. So you had a Catone picnic that cost the taxpayers $10,000, when in fact it should have stayed in the account. We could have used it to buy turf. That's called mismanagement. And not only mismanagement, who in the world is watching this account, Mayor? You're in charge. You're the elected officials. You're the ones that are responsible. There's a whole load of these things. And I'm flabbergasted to see it. After 13 years coming to this town hall, asking for, and I've asked information over the many years, it never once came up that there was this account. Not, we always see the budget, we talk about the budget, but not this account. This account was secret to the taxpayer until the superintendent made a mistake. And I asked him on that mistake, and I found out, and then that's how it surfaced. And how many more accounts do we have? How many times have money come from the Board of Education into this account? Because I don't know. I'm just theorizing. But it's a hell of a good conduit to hide money, especially for budget purposes. And then to jack the taxes up. And later on, they move the money back, because nobody knows about it. What are you going to do about that? Yeah, raise your head. I can't depend on you people. I've been coming here for 14 years, and we have this mess. I can go on, and I know I ran up my 5 minutes, Mayor, and I appreciate you giving me time. But I'm going to come back, and I'm going to read.
Can we get to ask you for a copy before you leave this evening?
I'll send you an email with the attachment.
Thank you. Thank you, Bob.
But the fact remains, this should not be nobody should, this should not, this should be out in the wide open for everybody to see. I asked to see, and I sent an email to the manager to see how many, who's requesting these fields? Where's money coming from? Is anybody keeping track of that? I guess I, as a private citizen, am going to have to do that, because there's no confidence here. You've proven yourself. I've complained about this for a long time, off and on, and no action. So you got problems. But yes, I will send that to you, Mayor, and not only you, every one of you.
Appreciate it. Thank you. Someone else wishing to speak? Public comment? Okay, thank you. Council reports? Tony? You're going to set up Jeff?
Yeah, later.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay, last Thursday there was a meeting to go over the artificial turf with all the various sports groups, coaches that would be involved in the use of Catone Field when the new turf is put down. Councilor Spinella and I were both there. Various groups brought in their suggestions, their comments. Luke McCoy, our consultant who will be putting the RFP together, as well as overseeing the project when it was done, was there taking notes. This was a first draft. He's putting all the stuff together, and once he goes over, gets it done, goes over with the manager, they'll have a 1 second stakeholders meeting with all groups involved to finalize before it goes out to bid.
No. It'll go out to bid, then we'll meet
them. Okay. And just to make sure everything is covered, and then we'll work to get this thing done by in plenty of time before football practice starts in August.
Thank you, Tony. Other council reports? Any council comments?
Mike Rell? Just wanted to, well, priority-wise, the Taste of Weathersfield is coming up this Saturday at the Keeney Center. I believe tickets are $35 in advance, $40 at the door, benefits the Historical Society. There is also a, this is a follow-up to a hearing that was held here in January for Brainerd Airport, the clearing of trees to the south end of the airport. I believe there's three public hearings, one in Hartford, one in Glastonbury, and then the final one here in Weathersfield, here in town council chambers, April 27th at 7 p.m. So if anybody's interested in the proposed clearing of the airport, here it is, I believe, yeah, 7 o'clock on the 27th here.
Thank you, Mike. Tony?
Last Thursday, I attended an open house for Quantum Corporation. They just moved into the two floors of the 936 Silas Dean Highway building. They merged the two floors together in an open air modern facade. It really looks great in there, as well as took over some additional space at 912 Silas Dean Highway. It's a group that provides quality education, support, and consultation to the healthcare community. And I welcome them to town and expect good things out of these new this new business in town, and wish them well on behalf of the town.
Thank you, Tony. Appreciate you being there.
Mike. I know we asked for the legislatures to come down, kind of talk about the budget. I know they're not able to make it tonight, but it would be nice if they can make it next time, even if they don't have a solid budget, just to kind of, I think everybody's a little tense about this year's budget. It would be nice to hear from a couple of them just kind of what their thoughts are, especially we're starting our budget cycle really on the 8th is our first major meeting this Saturday, so it would be nice to have them come down and talk to us. Another thing maybe for next time, just get an update on the Ridge Road apartments. I know there was some blasting supposed to take place and stuff, so if we can just get some information on that.
What would you and like? Because I can answer questions this evening.
Oh, sure. Just did the blasting take place? Are there are there more? Are some of the residents up there thinking there's going to be concerns? Have you heard from a lot of them?
There was a public hearing a couple weeks ago. About five of the residents came out. There'll be pre-blasting surveys done for all the properties. The fire marshal is the one that issues the permit. He's been meeting with the neighbors. He's been meeting with the blaster. What it is it's a very small piece on the far side of the property where the elevator pit's going to go. So it's a mixture of depth and, you know, if you use less material, you have to blast more times. If you use more material, you have to blast less time. It's a mix. So they're processing the permits through the fire marshal's office. And it'll be sometime in the next 6 weeks or so.
Is he there when they do the blasting?
Yes, he'll be there. Either he or his deputy will be there when the blasting actually occurs.
And then one more would be, and I don't know if we have any update on the Fun Zone property.
You want to cover? You want me to?
You can cover.
Okay. Yeah, they had the second P&Z meeting, Mike, on it, and there's some minor changes that they're making in response to that, and then they met with I think he met briefly with Jeff last week to talk about the time frame in terms of what's going to happen going forward. So there's still maybe another 3 weeks or so of changes in the engineering drawings with the intent to get something finalized, and then he's planning to come to council and present a final engineering drawing probably sometime in the month of April.
They also met with staff last week and went over the plan, access points, sewer and water, parking, all those things.
Yeah. Thanks.
Thanks, Mike.
I got a question. The I know that the budget's supposed to be adopted by May 15th. Mm-hmm. What if it isn't?
Well, you know, we really have to by charter. I don't know of any provision, and I don't think Jeff has ever seen it requested that we seek to extend appropriation past the 15th by charter. I'm just going to get ahead of your question. I think, Anthony, I assume you're saying it would be nice if we had a little more information from the state before we had to pass our budget. We've got a couple moving parts. It's not likely that we're going to get all that in front of us much before June from the state, from what the delegation is sharing with us. So, but right now, I'm not aware of any provision that allows us to extend our charter requirement to post a budget by the 15th of May. I know there was some legislation proposed at the state's level to allow us to override that, and it did not get out of committee. So as of right now, I'm not aware of any provision allows us.
The only reason I bring it up is because I've become aware that many town attorneys are telling their towns that the word shall be adopted does not mean shall, and that I think maybe we should ask for an opinion on that from our town attorney as
okay.
to what there seems to be no penalty for not doing it, I guess is my point.
Well, what you run into and what the conversation has been across the state is in the event, if your charter says you'll adopt a budget by a certain date, in the event you don't, it, for an aggrieved taxpayer, they can challenge the validity of your budget and your tax bill since you didn't follow your own rules in the adoption of a budget and the levying of a tax. That's the risk you take.
Okay.
Of not adopting per your own charter. I think the best thing we can hope for is, well, the best thing we can hope for is that after the April tax returns are known, the legislature can put a budget together or at least give us some better direction than what we have now by May 15th. Secondarily, if that doesn't happen, a reintroduction of the bill that basically preempts all local charters and allows for some adjustments after the legislature adopts a budget. I think those are really the two things. Either one has to happen for any town in Connecticut to have an accurate budget put together and accurate tax bill sent out. Some may levy too many taxes, some may levy not enough.
Right, so the reason I brought it up is I know some towns, if you don't adopt by that the final cutoff date, automatically the town manager's budget becomes the budget. And I noticed that we don't have that provision that I saw.
That's correct.
So I didn't see a penalty of any sort, but you're saying it's the taxpayer.
Right, the taxpayer enforces the charter.
Okay.
Other council comments?
I just had another quick question based on I was reminded by the Weathersfield Early Childhood Collaborative, one of the screens they looked at. But every year around this time, we end up with, I get a number of calls from folks from Little League, softball, all of that. And I know Kathy's here. Maybe at some point we can get an update just on where we are. I know the big storm last week had to kill a lot of that. But just so we have a sense of where we are on that, I know April vacation is typically the start of, or right afterwards, I think, the start of the Little League season. And just so we know where we're at on that, because, again, it's, I can't think of a year that I haven't gotten a number of calls just about fields and what the status is. So I don't know if Jeff can do that or Kathy. Or
I'll leave it up to Kathy.
Okay.
Or
it. No, it can be.
Well, when you're done the council comments, as I'm setting up to go over, you can.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Steve. Okay, why don't you go ahead and set up? Kathy, why don't you go and make reference to that while
now Jeff is time. Doing that. Thanks, Kathy. And just a brief update, I don't need anything.
Well, I think it's pretty easy to understand the weather has not been in our favor. And currently, the high school was supposed to start some of their games this week. They've postponed till next week. So we're hoping we get the weather this week to get onto their fields and get their fields up and going. The weather forecast for this week isn't the greatest either. So it's just a matter of the fields just have to dry out. Little League opening day, I believe, April 22nd is the Saturday, if that's the Saturday. So that's what they're shooting for. Soccer, lacrosse, softball, they're all looking sooner rather than later. So it's just a matter of getting the fields dried out. And yesterday and today were nice days. And I'm not sure what tomorrow's going to bring. So it's kind of, they're doing the best they can with just the weather.
Thanks. And I haven't gotten any calls, but just seeing one of those screens reminded me it's that time of year again.
Yep.
And
yeah, they're doing the high school fields are the priority. And then we move on from there. And some of the high school fields are also used by the sports groups. So that sort of gets the first jump.
Okay. Thank you.
Thanks, Cap.
And for those of you that didn't get a chance to see it, let me get over the microphone. As you know, the girls' varsity softball team will be playing on Little Catone. That was part of the renovation. And if you get a chance before the season's over, we've painted that as a softball field. So we've used turf paint and painted brown patches where the bases are, baselines. It looks pretty good. And it's a good model for going forward when we redo the turf on Catone. The goal is to use softball turf on Little Catone for the girls' softball team. It'll be probably a first-class softball field for the varsity girls, which can be used by every softball team all day long because the lines will actually be stitched in. The home plate will be stitched in, all these things. So you could play on it all day. You're never going to have to redo the lines. You won't have to refinish the field. You just keep playing all day long. So it provides opportunities for the recreation department to move things around and create more opportunities for other sports on other fields, since you can kind of coalesce all the softball in one location and play on it all day long without a problem. Tonight I'm just going to give you the high-level view of the budget. There'll be a more detailed presentation at the public hearing, which is in 2 weeks from this evening, per charter. So, do you have the microphone? Over, I can't talk and not walk. Okay, so the premise of our budget, because we don't have any better numbers, is we use the governor's budget recommendation. Now, we fully understand that there's a universal acceptance that that budget will not be what's eventually adopted by the legislature. But in the absence of anything else, we use the governor's budget numbers to comply with the charter and present you all a budget by the first Monday in April. Using the governor's budget numbers, which include the teachers' pensions, by the way, and that's what's kind of really driving this number. The total budget increases to $104 million. It increases $6.53% from the current budget. The proposed mill rate is 40.7. Okay. Now, that's for real estate. Under the governor's budget proposal, motor vehicles are capped at 32 mills. So when you mix the two together, the average property taxpayer will see an increase of about $325. Okay. And again, what's really driving that number is the teachers' pensions. Weathersfield was, however, fortunate to get more money than the other 130 towns, but we also, again, got the teachers' pension allocation, which is driving our number. So if you look, these are just the increases, part of that 6.4 million. So you see 2.8 is teacher pensions. The Board of Ed budget, which includes their, what we heard last time, contractual obligations, their pensions, their retirement benefits, their other needs. So then we had MDC, which is 207,000. We did not include the MDC reserve assessment to the town. If we had, we would increase that by about $650,000. Legislation is winding its way through Hartford, or the legislature, which would provide the relief to the member towns and allow MDC to use its own devices to overcome any default by the city of Hartford without levying a tax or an extra tax on the other member towns. Pension non-BOE is up $187,000. The asset values of the pension fund went down last year. So we're seeing an enhanced or an increase in pension obligations. Now next year, not the 2017-18 budget, but the 18-19 budget, we expect to have new mortality tables and again, lowering of the discount rate. So those numbers, are long-term obligations, are expected to rise, mostly due to the increased mortality or increased longevity of people due to the new mortality tables. Retiree health benefits, again, non-BOE. That includes employees that retired, that get retiree health benefits, and our contribution to the OPEB trust fund. Those are the two numbers there. Electricity, again, non-BOE. That's mostly for the streetlights. Streetlight rates went up. And as we go through the budget process, we may have a better handle on the streetlight project where we're actually buying them from CLMP. So we may be able to make an adjustment to that before adoption, depending on how close we are to assuming that responsibility for the streetlights. Insurance went up mostly, and that's liability auto property. That's mostly due to the increased value of the high school. Now that it's complete, it has a higher insurance obligation because there's all kinds of new stuff and new furniture, new equipment, a new building for the most part. So that increased the value, insured value. The big topic of discussion is, of course, municipal aid. You can see that Weathersfield was one of the handful of towns that actually received more. I'm going to call your attention to one particular number. The municipal revenue sharing motor vehicle, it's about halfway down, a little bit more than halfway down, $933,000. That is supposed to replace the motor vehicle taxes that the town would not collect because they're capping the mill rate at 32 from 37. Current mill rate's 37. They're dropping the rate to 32. We're supposed to be reimbursed for that differential. The actual differential based upon the mill levy is $1.4 million, okay? So because there's a gap there, we're taking about $500,000 of what would have been motor vehicle taxes and shifting it to the real estate, okay? They're using the 2015 mill rates to calculate the reimbursements on that number. So, of course, we're not getting the full reimbursement from the cap. You see we are receiving an ECS enhancement. One number that's not on this screen and not accounted for in the overall budget is a $4 million, roughly, special ed excess cost grant that goes directly to the Board of Education. I don't know how they've used that in their budget, but it's something that shows up on their side. It's a reimbursement. So as we work through the budget process, we have to get a grasp on how that impacts their budget and how that impacts their overall cost structure. So, just some general comments. There's no new positions in the town budget. We're using a status quo in terms of level of service. What we do today, we'll do tomorrow. We're spending $1.5 million on roads. The LOSIP account has been refunded for next year. So that brings our road spending back up to the $1.5 million. There's $901,000 on other capital improvements. That's the same number roughly as this year. Our projected fund balance is 10.5%. That's down from the current year, not because we spent it, but because the fund balance is a ratio of the general fund expenses. So as the general fund expenses go up, the amount of cash is a lower percentage in that fund. So I imagine if the teacher's pension and some of these other things flesh out, of course that number will go up. And again, we're shifting $506,000 of property taxation from motor vehicles to real estate in the current scenario if things change. The budget is online. We did, in the manager's message, produce an alternate budget based upon the same expenses, but without the teachers' pensions and the revenues at more or less the current year's revenues. And at that one, the mill rate drops to 40.3. Again, the debt service on the high school, $728,000 is another big driver. So again, this is a high level view. We're using the governor's numbers. We hope to get some better ones. It'd be great to keep the excess revenue and give up the teachers' pensions. That'd be a win-win, at least for us. But I don't see that happening. So it's a very chaotic time in budgets across Connecticut. Be happy to answer any questions. You all have.
Jeff, you did say this is online, right? For
people. It is online. There's copies in the clerk's office. There's copies in the library. We do have a few bound copies in my office if anybody feels the need to have one. I want to thank Mike and his crew for a great job again. A lot of analytics in this budget. We try to get the numbers down to almost a science, right? Right. So he did a great job this year, and we're short in that office right now. So my hat's off to Mike and his crew and Cheryl in my office for putting this together.
Any questions from council for Jeff?
Jeff, your alternative budget?
Mm-hmm.
So on that, you took out the pension cost, teacher pension cost.
Teacher pension cost.
And then for the municipal aid, you put it at basically what this year's aid was, is that?
Yeah, that's correct.
All right, so not what the governor has said, but just sort of.
Yeah, we kind of.
It's kind of a hybrid.
Right, kind of a hybrid to see what would happen if. So it brings it down somewhat.
Thanks, Jeff. One of the drivers is debt service. Mm-hmm. And every year we keep talking about plateauing and mm-hmm. getting to that point.
Correct.
Where are we in that, making that final top payment before we start to go down?
Yes. This budget we're preparing now will see the debt service for the town peak, hold steady, and drop in the next couple of years. We don't see an increase any longer. We've issued the bonds for the high school. We do have a technology item to work out with the board, but it should not increase at all anymore after this year.
Take out the variables that are going on up in Hartford with, mm-hmm. What's going on. The driver for the 40.7 or 40.3 mill rate mm-hmm. is debt service then.
Well, yeah, debt service, you have the Board of Ed, you have MDC,
but on healthcare. The town side, for us, I mean, MDC was 200 and
207. So debt service.
Debt service, $750,000, 700 and change.
Yeah, between debt service and MDC, we're close to $1 million.
Yep. And that's without contractual?
Contractual is about 200 grand on the town side. We got health care, because some are still in the HSA, some aren't. Retiree health is getting to be an issue because every person that retires that's eligible for retiree health, they stay on the active plan until 65. We hire a person to replace them because we're not riffing out people. You now doubled your health care spend for that position. So that'll increase over time. And I also made a comment in my message that both the pension and the OPEB obligations under the current revenue mix, where we are so dependent on the property tax, it's our only real viable revenue stream. It's just going to keep going. We need to find a way to work with the legislature to get a revenue mix that's more elastic or has a growth potential other than the property tax, because it is damaging. Town of Weathersfield gets 16 to 17% of its education budget from the state of Connecticut. That's what's really driving your budget. It's not the education spend. It's the amount of money we get other than property taxes to fund that obligation. And again, probably better than everybody, there's a lot of lawsuits about that right now. Okay. Mm-hmm. So that's
mandate
a challenge.
Relief. Mandate relief. We should be looking at talking to the legislature about that as well.
There's a lot of talk. Okay. We'll just have to see what happens. Hopefully the municipal revenue sharing account that we saw, where we're going to see a healthy increase, $500,000, stays. That would be helpful, very helpful. We're thankful for the governor for doing that. But again, you've got a $1.5 billion or so hole in your budget. Who knows? Who knows what's going to happen?
Any other comments?
Just following up on Mike's, the debt service, I know it's plateauing, but my memory was it starts to drop relatively quickly after that. Is it the next budget, or do we have two more to go?
Two more to go. We're going to use the premium we got on the bond sales to soft landing that. So without the premium, the debt service would somewhat increase because we did some refundings and restructuring years ago. But we're using that to smooth the whole thing. So we're knocking down the peak, smoothing it off for a couple of years, and then it drops. What is it, 2 years, 3 years from now? 3 years? 3 years, you get a small drop. 4 years, you get a pretty hefty drop.
Yeah, I remember the, at least the charts we had seen, it was a pretty significant drop at some point, but I didn't think we were there yet.
No, you'll have those as part of the budget review process.
Okay.
Else?
Thank you, Jeff.
I do have a couple other items, non-budget related. I'm going to hand that back to Dolores. In the paper, I think in a couple different publications, we saw where the town had taken ownership of a couple parcels of land through the tax sale. That was an error. The person who wrote that up, those parcels were in a tax sale. They were sold at the sale, but they were redeemed prior to the town taking possession, so we never took possession of those properties. They just didn't get it right. We've gotten several calls on that. We did take possession of a property called the Logos property. It was on the list for the Conservation Commission. It's adjacent to some already open space. This was a landlocked lot. So that one also went to tax sale. We did take that one assumed ownership of that one because it was not redeemed by the owner.
Where is that?
Oh, I can give you a map. It's you can't get there from here. It's out there. It's a small lot. We'll get you a map on where that is. But that's what I have.
Just one follow-up. Speaking of lots, the new developments down Whippoorwill, mm-hmm. Newington Line, are we looking at any of those coming online anytime soon? And what would assessed values, how would that hopefully benefit the town?
Sure. The grand list is prepared as of October for the forthcoming budget year. The current state law allows the assessors to do partial assessments. So as those progress through their various stages of construction, we can increase their value. There wasn't a lot out there as of October. So next year and the years after, we hope to see some value. These are expensive homes. The one on the far side near Back Lane, they're talking about $700,000 a piece. The ones closer in are not as much, but very nice homes. So the total value of that whole project, the 28 lots or so, should be relatively substantial value. And we'll again, raise those values as the construction progresses. Now, there is a bill working through the legislature that would prohibit an assessor from doing partial assessments on single, double, and up to four family homes that are under construction. They would have to be assessed at raw land values. Town Assessor Fauna Eller wrote some testimony against that bill today. I think when you do invest in a property, you do add value. You can sell it for more money. I think it's just the nature of real estate and development that you take on liability when you take on those things. So we'll see how that bill goes, but they run it every year. We'll see how it goes.
Hey, Jeff.
Okay. Thank you.
Dolores, anything?
Yes. I'd like to remind everybody that this is National Public Health Week, so congratulations to the Central Connecticut Health District, one of the first districts formed in Connecticut, and it's 21 years old. We also have Arbor Day, April 29th, 9:30, Broad Street Green. Fourth graders will do a program. We have a paper shredding day for at the Picking Center on May 11th. And that has been advertised, and you can see it online, because all of these note things are on the town calendar online.
Thanks, Dolores. We'll move on to council action. I don't believe I have any ordinances or appointments or resignations at this time, so no unfinished business, so we can move right into 3A.
I'd like to make a motion to authorize the town manager to apply for and accept a Keene Foundation grant to support the intramural and tutoring program at the Celestine Middle School for $11,300 for the 2017-18 school year.
Second.
Motion and a second. Kathy, I assume you're here for this? Thank you.
Good evening again. I'm actually going to ask Erica to present this. She's been working on it, and it is a grant that we are looking to apply to the Keene Foundation.
Thanks, Kathy. Thanks, Erica.
Hi, good evening. So we will plan to apply, if able to, for the $11,300 for the intramural program at the middle school. This is the third year that it will be offered at the middle school. It's been a success every year. This upcoming year, we're looking to include tutoring as another program offered to the students. We have been working in collaboration with the PAC and the middle school. And this program has just been a great collaboration, and it's been great for the youth. Any Thank questions?
You. Questions for Erica about this through the Keene? Don?
I just have a question. Is this considered a town program or a school-based program?
It's run through social and youth services.
Okay.
Yep. But it's held at the middle school.
Other questions about it? Seeing none, we have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Erica. 3B.
Motion to authorize staff to apply for a small harbor improvement project program grant for a new boat launch for the Cove Park with the use of $105,500 from the Cove Preservation Fund for grant preparation and grant matching funds.
Second.
Motion and second. Kath?
This is a grant opportunity that came up unexpectedly, and we inquired if our boat launch ramp would be eligible for it, and they said yes. What it is we have currently been permitted. We've gone through a major permitting process over the past several years to improve the docks, the moorings, and the boat launch ramp down at the Cove. We got a federal grant to do the boat to do the moorings and the docks, and we're stymied because the cost of the boat launch ramp is right around $500,000. So this grant came up unexpectedly, and we thought we'd give it a shot and apply for it. And one of the questions in the grant is, do you have any matching funds to put towards it? And the Cove Preservation Fund is where all the boating fees go in, and we've been saving money in there to try and fund the boat launch ramp. So that's our recommendation, is to use some of the money in that fund to show it as matching funds towards this possible grant.
Terrific. Questions? So, Kath, the total cost looks to be, you know, obviously significantly more than both the grant and the grant match. So this would go toward building a portion of it? Or how would you proceed if you got this as a match?
What we would hope, I'm not sure how much money they'd give us, but we'd certainly ask for it, that when they came out with the grant, they said that the possibility existed of having maybe $7.5 million for cities and towns along waterfront property to do improvements. So we figured, why not? We'd ask for the whole thing and put up $100,000 towards it, which would be maybe about... I'm lousy at my percentages.
About 20%.
20%, yes.
Yeah, okay.
Forgot.
So, but it's possible they could give you the full
They
amount.
Might give us the whole thing,
okay.
And that's what we're going to ask for.
Okay. Thank you.
And we've shown a record of investment in there between the dredging project, the dock project. So I think we've got a good track record going into this competitive grant.
And one of the key things we have going for us is we're already permitted by the state to do this work, which is a couple-year process just to do it, so it may help us.
Where would this be in relation to where the docks are?
In relation to the new docks, if you're looking at the new docks, it would be to the right of the new docks, close to them. Kind of, if you can think of the little island that you drive around, yep. Has that little slope, it would be in that area. Because that's, if you think about it, it's the highest point that we have where we can make a slope going into the water for a new boat launch ramp. That was the reasoning for where the new docks are now, and the boat launch ramp would be adjacent to it.
Okay.
Anything, guys? Donna?
Just, I know it's not directly related to the grant, but how did the docks hold up over this past winter weather and then the increased rain that we've had? I know the water's up.
Well, that's the good thing about the new docks. They were designed to float with the water levels. So as far as we know, I haven't heard anything differently that it's floated well over the winter. We didn't get the real heavy freeze this winter, so that's usually a good thing for the docks, but they're designed for the freeze. But so far, they're probably doing better than our fields are.
Thank you, Kath. We have a motion and a second on this grant application. All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? Thank you.
Thank you, Kath.
Move on to 4A, bids, road milling.
Make a motion to approve Tilcon CT Inc. for paving, for pavement milling services under state contract 16PSX0206.
Second.
Motion and second. Jeff?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor and Council. I'd ask Town Engineer Derek Greger to go over this one and the next couple ones with you.
Good evening, everybody. My name is Derek Greger. I'm the town engineer. As the town does every year, we have two paving programs, usually in the spring and in the late summer, early fall. And what we've done in the past, a lot of municipalities do, is use the state contract for our milling and paving services for the economies of scale. They put out bids every year for both milling and for paving. We look at those bids. Contractors bid the prices based on the quantities of work. So reviewing what we have planned for this spring for our road milling, Tilcon was the low bid off the state contract that we were recommending that we proceed with for hiring them to do that work for this spring.
And these are the roads that are identified in the proposal as well, right, Derek?
That's correct.
Scheduled, assuming that that amount is funded?
Yes.
Okay. Questions, Council?
Derek, just out of curiosity, when did Tilcon get into the milling business?
It's relatively recently. They had acquired, from what I understand, they had a part in acquiring Costello, okay. Who had been doing work for a lot of years. I don't know if they necessarily absorbed the company or just ended up with their equipment and personnel. So, yes, they haven't done a lot of milling in that respect, but it's our understanding that the equipment and the staff that they're using for that milling is very consistent with, experienced personnel that have done that type of work before.
Because, in the past, the state bids either been Costello or Garrity. That was a surprise deal. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
See if they were just entering the field, but if they bought them out, then it's probably the same crew.
Yeah, because Costello did not bid on this. I don't think they're in existence for doing that type of work anymore.
And this is spring money that's already
appropriated for this year. Yep. Okay. Questions on any of that?
Yeah. How about all the? It looks like a lot of the roads are a mess. We still have money for potholes and all that for the rest of the roads.
Yes. We Jeff had mentioned earlier we spend $1.5 million a year on roads. About $1.1 million of that is for this milling and paving program. We allocate about $150,000 that goes to physical services for those types of repairs that come up, whether it be just pothole filling or deep surface repairs or other minor type of drainage improvements.
Derek, how are we with the utility companies and getting them responsible for, repaving some of their potholes, or not even potholes, like full-on, cutouts?
We do get they are required to get permits from us, so we know who does the work and where it's done and when it's done. Utility companies, it depends on the company. MDC, usually if they're doing an extensive type of road repair where they're doing water and sewer utilities, Generally speaking, they will come back and mill and pave the entire road, do curbs when necessary. Gas company, it's not, I guess the policy hasn't been as complete as that. They usually will come back. They do have to do trench repairs, which involves cutting back, doing initial temporary trench repairs. They come back, do a wider cut, put in the thicknesses of pavement we require, seal the joints. So we have worked with them. What we try to do with these, with this program is we've recently, we were here back in January with our consultant, we recently went through a pavement evaluation. We do put together a five-year plan, send that out to the utility companies so they can start looking ahead. Particularly when we're doing these types of work, obviously we don't want them coming back and cutting the roads. So I know these roads on this list that you see this spring have been on the list for a number of years. We have spoken with both the companies for this spring and for this fall, MDC, CNG, that have the underground utilities. They both gave us the clearance to go ahead that they have no plans other than emergency repairs that might come up for a leak. They have no plans to do work. They are out there right now canvassing these neighborhoods, asking residents that live there if they want to make service connections. Obviously, this is the time to do it before we get out there and do the milling. So we are trying to work very closely with them and at least give them as much heads up as we can for prepping for our work.
How about the spots on the roads where they've already done the utility work and because of the winter, you know, it's settled back further down. So now where it was once flush last summer, it's half a foot down.
We get those calls. The contractors that do the work for the utility companies are required to post a bond with us that we hold for 5 years. It's a $10,000 minimum bond. So they are on the hook basically for 5 years. So we do get quite a bit of those calls. We can look back through our records, see who did the work, when it was done. If it exceeds the 5 years, normally what we'll do is we'll make an event. Sometimes with the utility companies, because they're in town a lot, we can call them. They'll still come out and do the repairs for us, particularly themselves or their contractors that do a lot of work in town. Otherwise, if it's, you know, well beyond that or we don't have that mechanism to have them do it, some of that $150,000 is allocated to physical services where they can do this work. Or we have also our miscellaneous prep paving contractor that's available to do these work on those types of cases. Okay. But we are looking at new methods now to better track the work as it goes on so we can, based on staffing availability, have an inspector out in the field, watching them more when they're doing that work to help minimize the amount of those types of situations that occur. I mean, some of it you can't help, but we are, you know, trying to work towards trying to minimize that situation.
Great. Thank you. Thank you, Derek. Any other questions on this one? Motion and a second in front of us. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Any abstentions? Thank you. I know you're going to stay for B.
I'd like to make a motion to contract with Tilcon CT Inc. under State Contract 16 PSX 0209 for paving services.
Second.
Derek?
Okay. Well, as I stated earlier, again, for the state contract, we use them for our paving work. They had put out a bid this past winter, and looking at the quantities we estimate for this program, as you can see in the agenda item, Glossel Materials was slightly lower than Tilcon for this, about 3% lower, or the equivalent approximately $7,800 looking at the overall program. Being that this program is pretty extensive as far as what we're doing, but the estimate for all the work is a little over $700,000 worth of work for the spring. And it was staff's opinion that because we have Tilcon doing the milling work, it would be more effective and more efficient to have Tilcon also on board for the paving work. This particular program requires a lot of coordination. At times we have three different contractors. We have a contractor come in and do drainage tops and some drainage work ahead of time. Then we have the milling done. Then we have curbs pulled out by that initial contractor. They take out aprons. We have the paving come through, and then we have the other contractor come back. So there's a lot of coordination. Often that can be difficult. One thing we're trying to do is when we mill a road, we try and get to paving as quickly as we can, not to leave the milled surface exposed too long. Obviously, the longer, you know, we're taking off some of the road pavement thickness, the longer we allow traffic to be on it, the greater risk we are at damaging the road. So in the essence, or in the idea of trying to have better coordination between the contractor, having Tilcon responsible for both the milling and paving, we think will be helpful in coordinating our program so we can hold them more accountable for their schedules and try to get the work schedule as tightly as we can with them. So our recommendation was with Tilcon doing the milling. Tilcon has done a lot of the paving work in town in recent years. They're very familiar with our process. They've done a good job. We've been happy with the quality of their work. Nothing against Galasso. They are out there as a paving company. They have not worked in town, and we don't have a lot of experience with them here. So given how close it was in the bid pricing, we were recommending to go with Tocon as well. They, as I said, they have been our paving contractor in recent years.
Questions for Derek on this? Terrific. Okay, motion and second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? Abstentions? Thank you. And finally, 4C.
Motion to extend the contract with General Paving for 18 months at the stated negotiated unit prices.
Second.
Okay. Also related to our paving program, and as we discussed, also assisting physical services. General Paving has been working in town for a number of years. It's my understanding they've been working in town since about 2005. Their contract that we started in July 1st of 2014 was a three-year contract. It's set to expire June 30th of this year. In talking with them, they're interested in continuing to work in town. They've done very good work. They've been very responsive to us, both on the paving program side, as they are one of the contractors we have to move in and out around the milling and paving crews. Also, they've been very responsive to physical services as far as providing them support when the jobs such as drainage or road repairs or deep surface repairs are more extensive than our crews have time to do. They've been available to do that work. So in talking with them, they had offered, if we were willing to extend the contract, to reduce their unit prices that they had bid in 2014 by 5% for the duration of the extension. I know historically we've done 12-month extensions. I'm requesting an 18-month extension because I really would like to get away from trying to change contractors in the middle of the construction season, June 30th, July 1st. It's hard when we've got a lot of work going on to transition to another contractor. So the request is to extend the contract through 2018 at the reduced unit prices that they have agreed to. I believe there's a memo in your packets that showed what the unit price comparison were. Based on my experience, I feel that the pricing they've been working under has been very reasonable. Obviously, a 5% reduction off of that is even better. They've done good quality work. We've been really happy with what they have done in town. That's what the request was for. That memo I was referring to also had some additional technical clarifications that I want to work on them with as far as getting the contract tightened up a little bit. They agreed to all of those. So that was our request.
Thanks, Derek. Questions for Derek on that as well?
I have a question. The $175,000 for traffic control, does that include them paying our police officers overtime?
How it works with police under this contract is for our milling and paving programs that we do, that is something that we as town staff coordinate. We make the calls to set up the police. So when they do that work, it is strictly, it's paid directly out of the police department's budget. When they do work, they call in on their own if they're working for physical services, and they do calls in for police. They're paying for police services as one of the items here for uniform police for traffic control. They had bid it at 10 cents an hour, and that's what they bill out as if they need police control for that type of work that they're doing. The $175,000, I think you're referring to the third item down for traffic control. That is basically traffic control that they have to go out. They have to put in barricades, cones, have flagmen present. When it doesn't require a police officer, if it does require a police officer, the town staff itself will schedule for it. The $83,000 for the contract extension is a prorated amount based on what they have been paying, what we have been paying them for each program over the last five programs. We're through five. This spring will be the sixth for the three-year contract. And it includes the 5% reduction that they had agreed to in pricing.
Did I answer that, Michael?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Any other questions for Derek on this? Okay, we have a motion and second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? Thank you, Derek. It sounds like good work. A lot ahead. Hopefully the weather cooperates.
Yes. Thank you.
Before we sit down, I just want to say two things. The underground fuel tanks, we received two bids back. Derek is evaluating those. And I spoke to the mayor about having a meeting before the public hearing, maybe 6:30, so we can get that bid approved. That way we can get moving on those underground fuel tanks this summer and get them in the ground. Also, Derek is going to bid Cloverdale Pond improvements this week. So he's worked through all the permitting processes and he's got that ready to go. It's going to be a busy summer.
Thank you. Good updates.
Okay.
Appreciate it. Meeting minutes?
I'd like to make a motion to approve the meeting minutes of March 20th, 2017.
Second.
We have a motion second. Any changes or deletions? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Any abstentions? Thank you. Public comment? Mr. Young?
Good evening again. Robert Young, 20 Copper Mill Road. Earlier, the town manager had spoke about, and he mentioned the words grand list. Do we have an increase this year for our grand list?
Yes.
How much?
It's in the manager's message.
Oh, so I got to go find that. Okay. Thank you.
It's less than 1%.
How much?
Less than 1%.
Less than 1. Okay. Also, the manager had spoke tonight about debt service. What does that include? Does that include just the long-term debt? And how does the short-term debt play into this? When I say short-term, you borrow money for fire engines and bulldozers, backhoes and vehicles and whatever else. What's the differential in dollars between, and what is the makeup of your long-term debt and your other debt?
Should I answer?
Yeah, keep it brief, though, because okay. This is not a two-way exchange.
Okay. So when we talk about debt service, we are strictly speaking of general obligation long-term bonds.
Long-term bonds. Mm-hmm. That's it. Mm-hmm. So how much is the other debt?
Yeah, go ahead, finish.
There is a lease schedule in what we call the CNEF, and it's in the CNEF budget. It's in the budget document itself. It's in the message, actually. And that's where we have our revolving leases for our fleet.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. I will look that up.
Sure.
I mean, I'm just interested.
It's public.
Yep. It should be, yeah.
Of course. Yeah. Absolutely. And I'll be happy to answer any questions you have on it when you see it.
I had continued looking at other accounts that we have, and I, you know, granted, some of this stuff maybe we should talk about in 2 weeks, but I don't think so. I think we should talk about it now because it just might help push things along. And one of the big issues was the items that I spoke about earlier that were in the athletic fund. I sincerely believe that all belongs in the annual budget for the town of Weathersfield and off on the Board of Education. Those revenues, those expenditures belong there. And if they haven't been there, I don't understand why they're not. And, you know, I say this because the superintendent has never once mentioned that account. And are there other accounts? We don't know. I don't know. Maybe you all know. But it's something that I think the public should know, everything about the accounting of this town. And I was kind of surprised when I asked him a different kind of a question, and he did provide. And I was very surprised to see it. Yet I've said in the past, this town has two sets of books, or at least the Board of Education does. And now it's off on a different ledger. It's not on the mainframe that we would call Munis. It's on some other system. It's off the side. And nobody knows. Nobody controls it except for probably one or two people. And we don't even know how much control there is. Who writes the checks? Who signs the checks? Who collects the money from any of these events, if any money's collected at all? And we found out now There is no money. After all these years, no money to pay for a new turf field. And, you know, I go through that list, see a lot of trips taken, field trips. I see a lot of food being bought. I see a number of issues that just make me go through the ceiling. On the other hand, the town side has the same problem. I look at and I see different restaurants on here that you're buying like $4,200, $15,000, $1,000 worth of foods. And when I look at the detail of it, I see things like food for officers. I see Memorial Day parade food. I see lunch and learn, whatever in the world that is, EDIC lunch. Town manager's office, I don't know what that means. I see dinner special for Special Olympics. I see wilderness first aid. Golly, this one in this case is $300 and some. Babysitting pizza. We do a lot of babysitting in this town. And you know the sad thing is? Last week at the Board of Education meeting, the superintendent said that they got the pizza oven working at the high school. And you know, 2 years ago, while I kept coming to these meetings, the current administration at that time was looking at food problems, the drinks, all the sugar, the grinders and the pizzas and all that kind of stuff. And then I heard him say Tuesday night, that they got a pizza oven. Yet the Board of Education swore off in their food discussions that they were going to only serve healthy food. What happened to that? And when you look at this, this is all unhealthy food. And nobody, you know, people get diabetes. People get all kinds of bad stuff. We all get, many of us get fat from eating this bad stuff. And when the kids get that way, they stay that way. And we have an obese society. Just go walk into the city of Hartford and you see nothing but obese people. And, you know, we got a pizza oven in the high school. And that now turned the food industry, the food policies that we had, turned them right around. Something's wrong, Mayor. Unless they went and changed the food policies. But I mentioned a moment ago, here's Frankie Catering, $4,000. You know, you have a number of different restaurants, 500 to this one. And, you know, so, oh, Kinney Center. You spent $1,400 at the Kinney Center. We own that building, don't we? And we rent it to those people for $100, and here we're giving them back more money. We take care of that property for them. We take care of the snow removal. We take care of the cutting the grass and the shrubs and who knows whatever else. And if anything happens to it, we have to stand right there and take care of it, and they only pay $100 or some kind of a little number like that. And here we paid in one year $1,400. For something, you know? It doesn't make any sense, Mayor. When someone looks at this, it really casts a heck of a cloud across this group. I thought you were holding back and trying to save money. I see Brattleboro Retreat. I saw that 4 years ago and mentioned it. $17,000 for somebody to go to Brattleboro Retreat, and we all know what that is. I just don't get it, Mayor. And this is year after year I see this stuff, and I don't see any pulling back on the spending. But, something's got to be done, and you know, this economy, as I mentioned in my earlier talk, that economist, he said it's going to get tougher. And, you know, If you don't do your budget tough and join up, it's going to be even more difficult. We're losing people. We continue to lose people in the state of Connecticut. And I'm sure that we're losing them here in Wethersfield. I know houses that are empty. People have died off, and they're not even the families aren't selling them because they don't want to put up with the nonsense of selling at the moment. Maybe they think prices will go up someday under this rain here, but I doubt that. Have we seen our housing prices going up? 3 months ago, 2.5% in the Hartford Current,
actually, yeah,
three houses.
Last
3 months ago, I read in the Current where Rocky Hill, Wethersfield, and Newington were stagnant.
No, you read it wrong.
I read it wrong.
Yes, you
okay.
did, sir.
Great. I read it wrong. I'm looking forward to seeing these higher prices.
Thank you, Bob.
But thank you very much, and I will send that information to you.
I look
all
forward
of you.
To it. We'll look into it, I promise you. Someone else? Tom?
Tom Mazzarella, 600 Walker Hill. I won't keep you long. A couple thoughts about maintenance in the town and maintenance reserves. In the industry that I worked in, we had very expensive equipment that had finite life. And we put in place a program of maintenance reserves. For example, the football field with a 10-year predicted lifespan, rough cost of $100 million, we're talking about reserving $100,000 in your budget every year for 10 years. When the field expires and needs to be replaced, the money is there. The same could go for roof replacement on buildings. I know Jeff Bridges told me that they typically would use that as a capital expense when the time comes. But most of these roof systems have a finite life, you know, to 20 years, 25 years, whatever it may be. And I know it's hard to put money away when we don't have money, but I think that's a strong option that the town should consider implementing. Also, with regards to the football field, the number of participants that actually use the football field is relatively low. You have basically football, soccer, women's softball now, I guess. But the actual times the field is used is relatively low. I was looking at the pay-to-play fees for the high school athletic participants. Most of the teams get a charge between $80 and $60 per student per team, with the exception of the hockey team. Now, the hockey team needs a very expensive piece of equipment. They need a hockey rink. I believe they're still using Newington Arena. Ice time is $400 an hour in Newington. So there's a surcharge applied to all hockey players. They pay $400 instead of the $80. Significant increase. And I think the time has come where you might have to look at assessing those higher fees to the participants that use that field. And also for the out-of-town participants or out of Board of Education participants that the town leases the field to, you know, midget football and other maybe outside teams that come in and use the field. Maybe we have to look at what those costs are. I didn't see in the manager's snapshot of the budget, you know, where is that money actually going to come from for the football field. I know it was pushed through, seems rather quickly because you're trying to meet a deadline, but nevertheless, it's the cost of the entire capital budget for next year. So just thought you might want to consider that. Thanks.
Thank you, Tom. Any other public comment this evening? Thank you. Entertain a motion to adjourn.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you.
Yeah, I'll give you.